And after this dispensation of grace comes to a close, God's program with the nation Israel comes back into play, there's another prayer. This prayer was intended for the people who are going to be entering the tribulation period, that seven-year time of, the Bible calls it the time of Jacob's trouble. That'll be the next thing on Israel's prophetic calendar for the after the body of Christ has been caught up to be with the Lord in the air. Remember, Christ's disciples were given a taste of their kingdom at Pentecost. They were fully given a taste of that kingdom. But before that kingdom could be realized, there was a prophetic event that would have to occur first. It wasn't the dispensation of grace. They knew nothing about a dispensation of grace because God had kept this dispensation a secret. This program was a part of the mystery revealed by the Apostle Paul. So the next event on the prophetic calendar from Israel's point of view was the tribulation period that was right at their doorstep. Had God not pushed that forward in time and ushered in an age of grace through a new apostle? And this one is not the prayer of faith. It's not the prayer of peace. This one's rightly called by people the disciples' prayer. And it has special application to that tribulation period. Those folks who were being taught to pray in this manner, it has special application for those folks who will be entering that time period. So as they were taught to pray in this manner, we see why when we examine the prayer line by line. How does it begin? Now you folks know how it begins. It's recited in churches across the country, even in our day. It's recited as though it's a prayer for today. And while we're not to use vain repetition, it's recited like vain repetition. People just standing up and uttering together what is commonly called the Lord's Prayer. But the Lord wasn't praying. He has a prayer in Scripture, but he wasn't praying here. He was showing them the manner in which those folks of the earthly kingdom program were to be praying in light of the tribulation that was right at their door. Now let's take a quick look. How does it begin? I think everyone here knows. Matthew 6, chapter 9. After this manner, therefore, pray you. Now, Christ taught his disciples, as the tribulation period was right there at their doorstep, on their prophetic horizon, we could say, he's teaching them the manner in which they pray. What's the first two words? Which word comes first? Father that is ours? Our Father. Now, that's emphatic position. Our Father, which art in heaven. Now, stop right there for a moment. Today, as believers in the sin-resolving accomplishment of Christ's finished crosswork, we certainly enjoy a father-child relationship with God the Father. Absolutely we do. Paul said we call him Abba. We're not denying that. We rejoice in that, folks. That's a very special relationship, as you well know. But we need to understand at the time this prayer was given to the disciples of the earthly kingdom program, Gentiles did not have a father-child relationship with God the Father. Proof sits in the word itself. What standing with God the Father did the Gentiles have during the time this prayer was being taught to the disciples of the earthly kingdom program? Paul tells us in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12, read it with me. Note carefully that at that time, at what time? Prior to the dispensation of grace ushered in by the Apostle Paul, prior to the time that Christ was teaching, during the time that Christ was teaching these apostles, disciples how to pray, or the manner in which they were to pray, ye were what? Without. Ye Gentiles were without Christ. Why? Being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel. Strangers from the covenants of promise. Having no hope. And what are the next two words? Without, meaning apart from God in the world. Our Father, during Christ's earthly ministry. You see, to pray our Father was a prayer meant for believing Israel at that time and for a reason. The word our that opens the prayer had a specific group of people in mind when Christ gave this manner of praying to the disciples of that program. Israel was God's people at the time this prayer was being taught to the disciples of Israel. And God was Israel's God. The Gentiles were apart from God when this prayer was being manifested. According to the word of God, I'm sure you recall the Gentile woman who approached Christ. At first, he wouldn't even speak to her. In fact, I don't believe he ever did. He spoke to his disciples, not to her. She addressed him, and she had no right to address him in the way she did, because she was apart from God, without Christ, the Bible says, apart from Christ. She was never promised a Messiah. Israel was promised a Messiah. According to Scripture, when God was working Israel, what benefit did she have? Only what fell over the table from Israel's program, if they merited the benefits and the blessings of that program, which they did not. Only when Christ saw that this woman recognized her place of submission under the people of Israel, did Christ answer her request. But notice the statement that Christ made in Matthew 15:26. But he answered and said, it is not meet, means not fitting, not appropriate, to take whose bread? The children's bread. He was their father. And cast it to the dogs. Who were the children of God at that time? The children of God were the children of Israel, folks, at that point in time. They had a relationship with God. And that's what this prayer is all about, because the age of grace was a mystery not revealed to Paul. Heard about it, and it was revealed to him to reveal to us. Israel, these people were his children. He was their father. But what about the Gentiles at that time? Were they considered God's children when this prayer was being given by Christ to the disciples of that program? No. What did the Lord say to that Gentile woman again? It's not appropriate. It's not fitting to give the children's dog, his children's bread, rather, to dogs. Christ wasn't insulting that woman, by the way, as some people would think. He's simply telling it like it was. As that program was in progress and the Gentiles were supposed to reap what fell over Israel's table. The Gentiles during that period of time past, were not considered the children of God. They had no right at that point in time that Christ was teaching this prayer to his disciples to say, Our Father. So at the time this prayer is being taught, to pray Our Father meant that you recognized, if you were an Israelite, that you were in a covenant relationship with God. You were his children. A covenant of a relationship of which Paul tells us the Gentiles were aliens. That's the only basis by which a person could say Our Father. Certainly we can say it today. But all the way through the Old Testament, folks, time and time again, God said to Israel, I will be a father unto you. You will be my children. And now, as the Lord was teaching his disciples, the Jewish disciples, how to pray in light of their approaching tribulation period, he said, pray Our Father. In other words, recognize your covenant relationship with me, Israel. Recognize who I am and who you are in relation to me, Israel. Now, the next part of the prayer goes on to say, Hallowed be thy name. Why did he want them to pray, Hallowed be thy name? What significance would that be to Israel? What does the word hallowed mean? Well, it means holy. In fact, it comes from the same Greek word, holy. And the point Christ was making there was that the name of God was very important in God's program with the nation Israel. Remember, the Israelites were given the responsibility of making God's name known among the Gentiles. So I'm taking Ezekiel for a moment, and I think you'll be amazed at how many other statements from the prophetic program correspond to the disciples' prayer. The Israelites had the opportunity. Israel was given the responsibility of making God's name known among the Gentiles. Look at it with me. Now, at this point in time, the time of this passage, Israel had been disobedient to God. In fact, she was about to be dispersed and sent into captivity. Ezekiel wrote, as God revealed this, in Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 19, I scattered them among the heathen, and they were dispersed through the countries according to their way and according to their doings. I judged them. And when they entered unto the heathen, wherever they went, that word heathen is goi. What does it mean? Gentiles. When they came unto the heathen, wherever they went, they did what? Profaned my holy name. It was their responsibility to make it known to the Gentiles. And rather than making it known, they're profaning it. When they said to them, the Gentiles that is, these are the people of the Lord and are gone forth over his land. And the Gentiles could look at them and say, these are the people of the Lord? You suppose more than a few of them said, well, that's what it's all about. I don't want any part of that. But I had pity for mine holy name, which the house of Israel had profaned among the heathen, the very people they were supposed to make his name known to. They're profaning it in front of those folks wherever they went. Every time you see holy name, you can put in the words hallowed name. Same thing. Means the very same thing. Now notice verse 22. Therefore say unto the house of Israel, Ezekiel 36 verse 22. Thus saith the Lord God, I did not this for your sakes, O house of Israel, but for what? Mine holy name's sake, which ye have profaned among the Gentiles, same word, wherever you went. And I will sanctify my great name, which was profaned among the heathen, which ye have profaned in the midst of them. He's not letting them up. He's continued to pound as he's holding them down. And the heathen shall know that I am the Lord when? They shall know that I am the Lord, saith the Lord God, when I shall be sanctified in you before their eyes. God's going to do something with Israel in a time yet future. Time after time in this passage, God said, you have profaned my holy name, Israel. Now, when we come to the book of Matthew, Christ is among his disciples, the disciples of that program. And he's teaching them to pray in this manner, hallowed be thy name. You see why he's teaching them this? You know what he's teaching them there? He was saying, get back to your program and your responsibility, Israel. You're supposed to be making my name great and making my name known. Do what you're supposed to be doing and make God's name holy among all those you happen to run across. When you pray our Father, follow it up with hallowed be thy name. That's your responsibility, Israel. You see why Christ wanted them to pray in the manner he was teaching them? Let me point out one other passage. Right before the book of Matthew is the book of Malachi. The prophet Malachi made a similar statement. Notice Malachi chapter 1 verse 11. For from the rising of the sun, even unto the going down of the same, my name shall be great among the Gentiles. Who was going to see to that? Who had the responsibility to see to that? Israel. It was Israel's responsibility. Rather than do that, they profaned his holy name. And in every place incense shall be offered unto my name in a pure offering. For my name shall be great among the Gentiles, the heathen, saith the Lord of hosts. Israel had a tremendous responsibility to make God's name known among the Gentiles and to make it hallowed or holy. That's why Christ incorporated this into the way he was teaching them to pray at that time. To the tribulation Jew, to whom this prayer will specifically apply, when he prays, hallowed be thy name, he'll be acknowledging his responsibility to make God's name known among the Gentiles. And the fact that God's name is indeed holy, that's who he is. Which brings us to the next statement. Thy kingdom come. Now stop. Oh, now it's getting pretty clear to many of us that for whom this prayer was intended and why. Believe me, this will be a very heartfelt part of the prayer right here during the tribulation period that Israel has in their future. You see, during the time of Jacob's trouble, the Jews will be under tremendous persecution from the Antichrist. He'll be putting them to death for their faith. They'll be beheaded for their faith. You know what they'll be praying at that time? Thy kingdom come. Not thy church go to be with the Lord in the air. Thy kingdom, the promised earthly kingdom, come. The earthly kingdom to be set up right here on planet Earth. Because the only hope of deliverance for those believing Jews at that time will be the coming of the king and the setting up of the earthly kingdom. The next prophetic event after the tribulation period will be the millennial kingdom, the thousand-year reign of Christ. Christ comes to rule and reign over this planet. That will be the deliverance the Jew will be praying for, that kingdom. The only way of escape from the opposition these Jews will be experiencing during that tribulation period will be the coming of the promised earthly kingdom. They'll be praying, Lord, bring it on. Thy kingdom come. We want this kingdom. We need this kingdom. Tell me, is that the deliverance we saints of the heavenly citizenship promise or praying or to be praying today? Are we looking forward to the next event on Israel's prophetic calendar? Christ coming to establish Israel's promised earthly kingdom on the earth here. Or are we looking forward to the next mystery event revealed to Paul? He revealed it to us. Christ coming in the air to catch us up off of this planet. We need to understand, folks, the disciples' prayer was designed to reflect Israel's hope. Thy kingdom come. And that's why they'll be praying, thy kingdom come. Next we see, thy will be done in earth as it is being done right now, is the verb tense, in heaven. Now think about that. Thy will be done in earth as it is being done right now in heaven. Here sits a divine definition, folks, of the millennial kingdom. What is that kingdom? Well, the kingdom is when God's will be carried out here on earth to the same degree that at that time it will be being carried out in heaven. Notice that it talks about God's will being carried out on earth. Why is that a significant part of this prayer? For the Jews, because the Jews have an earthly hope. That's why. They were not looking forward to being in heaven. Understand, they were never promised heaven. They knew nothing of a heavenly citizenship. They were promised the earth for how long? Forever. We are the heavenly people of God. Paul tells us that our citizenship is where again? In heaven. But the Jews will be praying that God's will be carried out on earth to the same extent, to the same degree, that it will be already be being carried out in the heavenly realm. Now, this is an interesting thing here when you think about it. Stay with me here for a moment. The words are, thy will be done in earth as it is right now being done in heaven, is what they're to be praying. And yet, even today, is heaven not somewhat defiled? I'm not talking about the third heaven where God's throne room is. I'm talking about the second realm of the heavens, the stellar heavens. Satan still has access to the realm of the stellar heavens. Did you know that? Even at this very moment, Satan can come and go in that realm of heaven anytime he chooses. His angelic minions are doing his bidding in the stellar heavens right now. Not in the third heaven, as I said, where God resides, but can we say God's will is being totally done in heaven right now? If Satan still has access to the stellar heavens and the atmospheric heavens, two-thirds he has access to. How can we reconcile the words, thy will be done in earth, that is, it is being done in heaven right this very moment? We have to understand that the great persecution to come upon the Jewish nation, the persecution for which they were being taught this prayer, will come during a particular part of the tribulation period, namely the second half of the tribulation period. Let's take a look at a passage in Revelation chapter 12 for a moment, because something very significant happens halfway through the tribulation period. Notice it with me here in Revelation 12, 6. And the woman, who is this woman? This is the bride of Christ, believing Israel in that day. The woman fled where? Into the wilderness, where she hath a place prepared of God, and that they should feed her there 1,260 days. A prophetic year is 360 days. So if you do your quick math, you've got 3.5 years in this verse. So midway through the tribulation period, Michael and his angels do battle with Satan and his angels, and Satan and his angels are cast down and confined to the realm of the atmospheric heaven, to this earth. They know the time is short. There's only 3.5 years that remain before the trip, before Satan will be locked up for 1,000 years. Notice Revelation 12, verse 7 through 10. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. The dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not. Neither was their place found anymore in heaven. A reference to the stellar heavens, folks, because that's the only place Satan has access to other than the atmospheric heavens. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out right along with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down. Who will be proclaiming this? The angelic host that has access to the stellar heavens where Satan was just cast out, which accused them before our God day and night. You know what you've got here, folks? At the time when Israel will be facing the wrath of Satan, the time that Israel was being prepared for when they were being taught the manner in which they were to be praying, Satan will have been kicked out of the stellar heavens and cast down to the earth. And God's will indeed be being done where? In the realm where Satan has just been cast out. This prayer is appropriate for the people of that day, folks. The Jews will be praying at the time just as they had been taught to pray, thy will be done here, just like it's being right right now done there. You see it? This prayer has special significance to the second half of the tribulation period, when Israel will be facing all of the wrath that Satan can muster against those folks. Thy will be done in earth, that is being done at this very moment in heaven. The saints of the earthly kingdom program will be praying. What comes next? Matthew 6:11, give us this day, meaning give us today, our what? Daily bread. If you know your prophecy, you know that during the last half of that tribulation period,